Yeah, so in the last class, we started discussing about how to deal with the case when hypothesis just generates the labels, does not belong to our hypothesis class, right? We said we want to relax the realizability assumption, and we started defining what is the notion of performance criteria when we don't have this realizability case. So, we introduced the notion of regret, which was basically said like how good you are in hindsight, okay, how good you are in hindsight compared to how good your algorithm is performing compared to an algorithm which knew all the information, okay. So, just to reiterate that, we have defined our regret as so this was our notion of regret, and we said that our goal is to identify an algorithm which makes this regret sublinear, or alternately we said that this hypothesis class is learnable if I have an algorithm such that goes to 0. That is, regret per round goes to 0 as n tends to infinity. Okay, now let us try to understand what kind of bound we can expect on this quantity. Is it possible to achieve this at all? Can I come up with an algorithm which makes my hypothesis class learnable? Okay, now that I have removed the realizability assumption, the power of adversary is much more now, like maybe he can just look into the label what you predicted and then just give opposite of that as the true label, right. In that case, what could be this value? If the adversary can look into what is that you predicted, then what is the what is the maximum he can make this value? He can make it T, right, by just flipping what you predicted, he can make it fine. So, he can force you to this. Now, we will try to understand what this quantity can be for the simple case of two hypotheses. Let us say that this hypothesis class, take it to be consisting of just two hypotheses, H0 and H1, where H0 always says 0, H1 always says 1. Let us try to understand what this quantity is going to look like for this specific example. So, is this hypothesis class clear? This is a trivial hypothesis class, okay. Now, given any sequence of labels, let us say whatever the sequence, I have to look at this quantity over, because since I am doing a supremum over H, I will look into this quantity for only two H possible H values. One is H0 and another is H1. Now, irrespective of what is the sequence, if I am going to look at this value, so let's take this soup inside here. Instead of doing this, let's say I take here, I'm basically looking at infimum value of this quantity, right? What will be the infimum quantity of this What is that? Y 0. So, okay, let's say Y t sequence, right? So, if I have Y t sequence for t rounds, either if less than t by 2 are 0, rest of them are 1, or other way around, right? If less than t by 2 are 1, others are all 0. Now, because of this, if you are going to look at two possible things, h 0 has h 1, whatever this quantity can, by choosing one of this h 0 or h 1, depending on what your sequence is, can this quantity be made at least, at most t by 2, the mistakes? Okay, so let me put it. So, let us consider this quantity. So, let us say you have been given this y t sequence. Let us say now you have to predict using your hypothesis over h 0 h 1, you have to match this label sequence. Suppose let us say in this half of them are 0, less than t by 2 are 0 and the remaining ones are 1. By choosing your hypothesis class to be H1, which is always predicting 1, what this quantity can be? Less than t by 2, right? Because they are the one only mistake, remaining ones are always already 1, so there would not be error. Now look at the other possibility, where the first t by 2 are 1 and the remaining ones are 0. In this case, if you are going to choose this hypothesis H 0, what will be this bound? Again, it is going to be t by 2, right? Irrespective of what this sequence is going to be, if you are going to loop minimize it over H 0 or H 1, this guy is always going to be t by 2. Yeah, I mean, in that case, it is, this value is going to be 0, right? If environment give all this y t's to be 0, in that case, since you are minimizing, the best one is to choose 0. It is going to be upper bounded by 0, but we are taking the worst case. Irrespective of what is the sequence you are going to choose, if I have to choose one of them, then this quantity won't be more than t by 2. Okay. Now, if you go with this, this can be t, this remaining quantity can be at most t by 2. And if I want to, then can I get a bound on this like this for this problem? And because of this, this is going to be like t by 2. So, even for the simple case of two hypotheses here, we have a case here where this regret will be at least t by 2. That is what, right? Like this is, I had did it over arbitrary sequence. So, you do it for any possible sequence, still this is going to hold. Yeah, right? Like whatever the sequence, this bound is going to hold. Right? Now, because of this, we have a lower bound of t by 2. So, instead of t, I have been using n. Let us be consistent with that. Now, if I get a bound like this, like lower bound is n by 2, can I ever get a, can this hypothesis class will be learnable? No, right? Because if I divide it by n and let n go to infinity, this fraction is never going to be 0. It will be at least half, right? So, because of that, if we under this unrealizable case, there is no way that I can come up with an algorithm which makes this, even this such a simple hypothesis class learnable. And this is called like impossibility result. Okay, so this is a bad case, right? Like if adversary is so powerful that there is nothing you can make, like you will not be able to kind of get a sublinear regret here. Now, so what we will do is, instead of going to compete against such a powerful adversary, we will restrict again the adversary's power here. It's again in the unrealizable case only, but we will give bit more flexibility to the learner while we are restricting the power of adversary. So what we are going to do? First, we allow the learner to make probabilistic predictions. Okay, it's not necessary that he has to, in any round, his strategy has to be deterministic. He can, maybe in every round, he can have his own strategy where he is going to say a label 1 with some probability, even though he knows it is, he want to say it label 1, but he will only going to say it some probability. Okay. So even if I make this assumption, will anything change here in this? Will, if the learner is going to make a probabilistic decision, can this become learnable? Not really, right? Because when I said he is going to make y, t hat is the predictions made by the learner, I didn't say what is the strategy actually he is going to use. You could have used randomized strategy, but what was the case here? Like if the learner, adversary can see the final predictions made by the learner, then he could force such things here. So that is why, even though we have allowing the learner to make probabilistic predictions, we will further say that the adversary is going to come up with his label yt before learner makes his prediction yt hat. You understand this point? That is, he is not first in round t, learner this whatever, let us say in x n y n, in nth round, the adversary comes this prediction before he sees what is the prediction made by the learner in that round. Okay. So if we restrict that, then maybe like this kind of situations can be avoided, right? At least he can't make you to be wrong in every round. Okay. So when I say this point, second point, it is only for that particular round. Let's say I am in particular round T. In that round, adversary does not know a priori with what probability you are going to make a prediction of 1. And also he will not see what is the prediction that has been made in that round before he chooses his label. Okay. But he might have known all the predictions you have made in the past. He has that history. But what he does not know is, in that round, what is the probability which you are going to make a prediction, and what is the true label, what is the predicted label. Yeah. No. Right. So, okay, fine. We are not making that assumption here, right? We are not making that there is a relation like this. Yeah, so adversary is generating this according to his own logic. It could be doing this, but it's not necessary. Okay, the only restriction we are putting on the adversary is that he can't see your prediction because before he declares the label. Okay, now how does things change with this? So what we are making is we are kind of allowing the learner to kind of confuse the learner adversary also, right? Because you are making a randomized prediction. Maybe adversary, even if he looks what is the prediction you made finally, he may not be knowing what is the actual value you would have predicted, right? And now that you have also restricted this adversary's power, maybe in this case learner can do something better than this bad case where there is no way that a learner would have been able to learn even the simplest case here. Okay, fine. So with this assumption, yt hat in round t is no more deterministic, right? Because of that, we are going to now start dealing with what is the probability that yt equals to 1. So now this is the strategy of the learner. In each round, he is going to come up with probability with which he is going to declare the label to be 1. Okay, but what you care is, yeah, environment could be completely random. You also do random things. Maybe if the environment is totally random, if you somehow figure out that random things, you are now started doing as good as him, right? That will be our aim. Somehow you figured out the adversary is doing that with probability 1, he's flipping. He is declaring label 1 and probability half is declaring 0. Suppose you also did that. Do you think you will be able to do better? Like you have basically understood what the adversary is doing, right? That means you basically learned the environment. If there is a hypothesis which makes the label, that's fine for you, right? It will be, you should be able to figure out that. Now the question is, what happens if there need not exist a hypothesis class? Okay, so right now this is not obvious to you, but can we hold on this thought and see that without making this assumption, if we can show that we will come up with an algorithm such that this sublinear regret holds. So fine, all your question now is you are not able to see an algorithm which will guarantee this, right? But if we can eventually come up with an algorithm, that should tell you why that is possible, right? So we will exactly do that. Okay, so we'll try to show an algorithm such that this is indeed true. Okay, and there we will see that is it necessary to have this condition that there exists a hypothesis, or it is not at all necessary. Okay. So now the strategy of the learner is to, in every round, come up with this probability with which he is going to declare the label to be 1. Okay, fine. Now that the learner is randomizing his predictions, what we have to now do is we have to redefine this regret to be a regret in an expected sense, right? Because this quantity is no more deterministically chosen by the learner. Okay, so how to redefine this? So we are going to take the expected regret, which is going to take the expectation of this quantity over the randomness of the learner. Okay. So let me put an expectation here, and this is what I am going to now call as this expected regret. And now this quantity is no more, we are allowing this to be random quantity, right. So because of this, this quantity anyway is not going to change, there is nothing random here, right. Because for a given sequence these are fixed, and anyway your h is also fixed. Now anyway, given the sequence, this yt is fixed. Now what is going to change is this, depending on your strategy. Okay, now let us write this. So what, how can you write this quantity? So if I take the expectation here, I will just interested in knowing what is the, this quantity here, can I write it as indicator yt hat not equals to yt. And now if I take expectation of this indicator, what it will be, right. So in that case it is going to be probability that yt hat is not equals to yt, right. So I want to write this quantity. This quantity can be written as yt hat minus yt. So let us understand this. Okay. So just let me write this bit more clearly. Expectation of yt hat minus yt is equal to expectation of indicator yt hat not equals to yt, and this. So why this is true? Suppose let us say your yt is equals to 0. Sorry, let us begin with yt equals to 1. So yt equals to 1, yeah, yt equals to 1, that means what? You are saying yt hat not equals to 1, that means yt is basically 0. Okay, let us take the case yt equals to first 0. If yt equals to 0, the right hand quantity is simply pt, right? And what is this quantity here? Yt hat not equals to 0, that is same as saying yt hat equals to 1, right? And yt hat equals to 1 is exactly pt by our definition. So this is true. Now you similarly, if you take yt equals to 1, so now this quantity is like pt minus 1. Because of this mod, I can think this as simply 1 minus pt. And what is 1 minus pt? 1 minus pt is the probability that you make prediction to be 0. And this is exactly this, right? Like if yt equals to 1, this is like saying yt hat equals to 0, and that is 1 minus pt. So we have this relation. Because of that, if you simplify this quantity, we are going to write our regret as simply what is this quantity inside now? Can I write it as t equals to 1 to t my pt minus yt? Right? I just rewrote this. No, this is exactly that expectation we have removed, and then we showed that this is exactly this quantity, right? Is it not that what we just now argued? Yeah. No, there is a deterministic, nothing to do with expectation over here, right? The only random quantity. Okay, what is the difference between this quantity and that quantity there now? So here, this quantity yt hat was either 0 or 1, the prediction, right. But what is here, this quantity here is anything between 0 and 1, right? So we are just, now when we move from this setting to this setting, we are just saying that everything remains same, except that instead of saying that okay, yt hat has to be either 0 or 1, we are allowing it to be any value between 0 and 1. It is like any, here we are just, this is like when pt equals to some quantity, and this is just like probability of predicting label 1. Okay, so what? Now after you did this, we have redefined secret like this. Now am I interested in showing this to there exist an algorithm such that this quantity holds. So whenever this happens, we are going to say my regret is sublinear or my hypothesis class is learnable. Okay. So the next theorem we are going to make this bit more formal for so what this theorem is saying, you take any hypothesis class H. Right now we are not mentioning anything like this hypothesis class is finite or infinite. Okay, you just take any hypothesis class. There exists an algorithm for online classification. Notice that we are still in this classification regime, like 0, 1. We are, our predictions are always 0, 1. So we are just interested in classification so far. And whose predictions come from 0, 1. You remember, like instead of going the prediction to be 0, 1, we have translated it to predictions to be coming from 0, 1, which we interpreted as probability of giving label 1, such that you take any hypothesis, then this quantity will be upper bounded like this. All of you can see this and read it. So this quantity is nothing but the quantity inside whatever, inside this square brackets, and is going to be upper bounded by this. So what we are saying is, we are not, you take any hypothesis, use that as a benchmark, and now if you compare whatever the loss you are going to incur, this is going to be your regret bound. So it is saying that if you are going to use, like, let us say this fixed hypothesis class, okay. Now you compare the loss you incur with this fixed hypothesis class against the loss you incur by your policy. This difference in the loss is going to be upper bounded by this quantity. And this H could be any H that is coming from a hypothesis class. Yeah, in this like we already said that, right, if he uses this, he can force you a loss of total t. Yes, this theorem is valid, like, yeah, all the statements holds provided this condition holds. If any of this are violated, this theorem is no more guaranteed. Okay, all of you read what is bound here. So this is the L dimension of H. This is the log of cardinality of H. It is a bit complicated, but I think you can parse it. This is the log of ET. So this is one term here. L dimension of H into log ET and log H. The minimum of these two, whatever it is, you take this and this whole thing multiplied by T here. Okay, maybe, so this is the precise statement, but what we would be interested in a bit slightly weaker version of this. This is an arbitrary, this statement holds irrespective of what is the cardinality of your hypothesis class H. Okay. So, it may so happen that even though your hypothesis class has infinitely many points in that, but the L dimension of that hypothesis can be finite. In that case, this in the minimum term that will only make impact, like that has no meaning, I mean that has no importance there. So, similarly, it may happen that for some hypothesis class, even if it is, anyway, if the hypothesis class is finite, we know its L dimension is also going to be finite, right? Because we know that L dimension of hypothesis class H is upper bounded by what? Log of cardinality of H to the base 2. So, if H is a finite size, everything is fine. So, if H is infinitely many, then maybe like only thing that matters is this quantity, not this quantity. Okay, now suppose let us say, because this is a bit many terms here, suppose let us assume for time being my hypothesis class is finite. Okay, so in that case, can I write this bound like this? So, this is a simplified version of this when my hypothesis class is finite. Why this came? Because if I am going to take, this is the minimum of these two quantities, right? So, if I only take this quantity, it is still an upper bound on this. Is that clear? So, if I drop this and only retain this, it should be still an upper bound, because here I have a minimize. Instead of looking at minimum of these two terms, I am just take one of the terms. Okay. Now, if I have a bound like this, notice that this bound is independent of the sequence. Is that clear? It is independent of the clear, and this bound holds irrespective of what hypothesis you have chosen. Because of that, is this also bound on this quantity? Right? Now, can I say there exists an algorithm such that this holds? Why is that? Because here it is square root of n, right? This is some constant, but it is like growing like order square root n. So, this is, we are going to denote it like order square root n. All of you understand this order square root of n notation? So, this regret is order square root of n. And now, if you are going to divide square root of n by n and let n go to infinity, this quantity is going to be 0, right? So, this theorem is saying that hypothesis class H is going to be learnable as long as either it is going to be finite or that its little dimension is finite. If let us say either hypothesis class is, if its little dimension is going to be infinity, this upper bound is already vacuous, I cannot say anything. But as long as this little dimension is finite, we can always guarantee that there exists an algorithm which will make my hypothesis class learnable.